Let me introduce our very first tech guru, Ravishankar Shirur, to present key insights on IoT, a business revolution enabled by technology. Ravishankar Shirur is a co-founder and a co-founder of Stellapps, an end-to-end dairy technology solution company. Mr. Shirur is a technology expert with 25 plus years of experience in embedded software and telecommunications. He was a member of Wipro Center of Excellence and served as a strategic advisor for the likes of AT&T, Telstra, Nortel, and Ericsson. Mr. Shirur is a thought leader in the areas of STP, IoT, value-added services, and application. Let's all welcome Mr. Shirur, and let's hear how IoT as a technology brings business revolution and how it's a critical component in implementing the digital transformation in business. Over to you, Ravi.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. So today, I'm very glad to be here talking to all of you on the IoT masterclass today. So I wanted to start by sharing an incident that somebody else shared that made an impression on me as an engineer. Apparently, when Professor Einstein was teaching in New Jersey, he used to set question paper to his students. Every test or every exam, his secretary used to make copies of the question papers the day before. Professor used to share the question paper and he used to make the copies so that all students could write the exams or tests next day. One day, after the professor shared the question paper, the secretary came running back saying, Professor, I think by mistake you set the same question as last year. Einstein said, don't worry, I have changed the answers this time. The reason it makes such an impression is that the questions in our in the human life remain almost similar over centuries, right? I mean, how do we make the best use of the resources that we have? How do we make our lives more comfortable? How do we live on this planet without with the least possible disturbance to the planet? So these are some of the questions that we continuously need to answer, and the question remains the same, but the answers keep changing. The new answer of the current time seems to be that we need to leverage IoT, AI, and many of these solutions in order to answer these basic questions. So as we keep talking about smart everything, to make things smart, this is the new answer that we need to leverage in whatever questions that we are trying to answer. Could you put up the slideshow, Sandeep? You could move on to the next slide, please. So basically, firstly, let's look at what is formally defined as IoT, okay? You could click again. You could go, yeah, I'll use it, yeah. So IoT, internet, what is internet? Internet is basically something that all of us have been using now for some time. It is, use it to talk to each other. We use it to share information with each other. We use it to, communicate about a lot of data, emails, files, whether it is social networking, all of this. We have been using internet. I don't think we need to speak about internet anymore. But what are things, right? So things are basically the things that need not be very intelligent. Okay, I mean, we are of course using things also to communicate over internet. We are, computers have been talking to each other, servers have been talking to each other for some time, etc. But the everyday things, like whether it is a car, whether it is a building, whether it is a whether it is an animal like a cow, or whether it is our other vehicles on the road, etc. So how could we use things to make use of internet is the theme behind IoT. It allows the objects, or the things, to be sensed and controlled remotely across the existing network infrastructure. As we have seen, the network infrastructure has been is almost becoming available everywhere. I mean, even if we go to the village side, in the very rural side of India today, internet is available. So how, the IoT allows the things or objects to be sensed and controlled. As per the definition of IoT, sensing is done by the by using sensors. There are more than 1,400 physical attributes that can be used to sense, and actuators are used to control the real life objects based on the information that is obtained from these sensors. So Mr. Kevin Ashton in 1999 coined the term IoT. Earlier it was also called as machine to machine communications. I have been a telecommunication engineer throughout my life, and telecom industry loves to sell more SIMs, right? I mean, at some point of time, we ran out of human beings to sell SIM cards. The telecommunication industry thought about, okay, can we sell SIM cards to machines? And that's how the M2M terminology came into picture. Even today, if you are working with telecom service providers, they sell you M2M SIMs. So it was earlier known as M2M, and in 1999, the term IoT was launched, was coined by Kevin Ashton. So why IoT? As I said already, it is answering our, the common questions that we as engineers keep trying to answer using, the answers we have at our hands. So we keep, all of us are now talking about smart cities, smart hospitals, smart transport, smart precision agri, smart grid, all these things that we keep talking about, trying to maximize what we can do using the resources that are available. And as we know today, cloud computing and edge computing are becoming more and more powerful. You can apply a lot of intelligence once you get the data into the cloud. So IoT as a technology theme allows you to get the data from these real life objects in almost near real time, depending on the application that we're talking about, to the cloud. And once in cloud, one can apply the intelligence on the data that is being obtained in order to derive the efficiency, accuracy, and economic benefit that we expect. So some of the use cases that we are aware, smart homes. Of course, it's about, how do we manage the environment in the house, the resources that we use in the homes, security, and these aspects can be addressed with smart homes. Smart metering is about how to leverage, we are talking about smart metering in the electricity consumption. How do we charge the customer more or less or optimally based on the load conditions? So that is about smart metering. intelligent transport. Of course, all of us are talking about today driverless vehicles and how to make traffic more efficient, how to make traffic signals more efficient, how to make law enforcement more efficient, and so on. Smart hospitals, again, you know, the availability of the resources in the hospitals or the medical staff need not be a limitation if you are leveraging the technologies. Precision agri is a new area, and that's an area that we are focusing at STRAPS as well. So how to make the resources consumption, again, in the agriculture sector more efficient is the focus of the precision agri. And smart grid is about how to manage the grid more efficiently. Of course, these are not the limited use cases. There can be any amount of use cases with the same theme of IoT that can be leveraged. So IoT as an architecture, if I talk a little bit about, so the lowermost or the physical layer is the things that we are trying to track, or the objects that we are trying to track, and the sensors. In this slide, the top part is the connectivity view, how the data flows from one point to the other point. As I said, IoT is about getting the data from the objects or the things in the real life to the cloud, and then delivering data to the users or control the things back. So the data flows from the things based on the sensors that are being deployed to a gateway. And the gateway then communicates over a higher bandwidth network infrastructure to the cloud. From the things or the sensors, the gateway communication happens usually over a personal area network or a local area network. Usually the sensors are constrained devices in terms of power availability, in terms of the computing ability, and other limitations like the working environment, etc. They have to work in pretty much harsh environment. It might have to be required to withstand natural elements such as rain, dust, and so on. So the one of the very key important aspect is to select the right sensors. And the second part is the gateway. Gateway usually is not that constrained device, and it leverages the higher bandwidth network that is available out there to send the data to the cloud. And in the cloud, the data is computed. Any other intelligence can be applied on it. Artificial intelligence can be applied on it. Big data analytics, all kind of available techniques can be used to make sense of these zeros and ones that are coming from the things out there. And then data is given to the users, or it can be used to control the real life objects again back. So the bottom part is about the user interface view, or the user interaction view. Firstly, you need to have a good device management aspects, OSS, BSS aspects of the telecom era to manage the devices that have been deployed out there. And then, of course, the application logic, rules, big data analytics, etc. can be applied, and data has to be stored securely. Security is an important aspect more and more as we start collecting more and more data about the real world out there, and how to store the data in a seamless manner. Little bit in depth, if we look at the architecture of the IoT, the bottommost layer, as I said, is about the type of sensors. Choosing a sensor is an extremely important point in designing any IoT solution. There are any kinds of sensors available firstly, what is the physical attribute that we are trying to measure? That is an important aspect to consider. What is the accuracy that we are looking for? What is the which depends on the application? Am I putting the sensor on a satellite, or am I putting a sensor on a vegetable truck? Am I putting a sensor on a cow, or am I putting a sensor on a device inside a factory? Depending on those, I might have to look for what is the right accuracy I'm looking for. What is the power supply that the sensor can expect to have? Is it battery based? Can it get some kind of a power? Can it charge based on solar? So these are some of the aspects that can be considered when selecting the right sensor. And of course, the economics has to matter too. What is the what is it that the application or the user can afford to pay for this is an important aspect. Based on that, the right sensor has to be used, and supply chain has to be looked at as well. As if you are looking at designing mass solutions, if you are looking at rolling out millions of components, we need to make sure that the sensor or components that we select can be procured in larger numbers over the years as we deploy the solutions in bigger numbers. And also, what is the in the lowermost layer, we also need to consider what is the personal area network that we are going to choose for this application. Can I you afford to use something like Wi-Fi, where I need a little bit more power, or should I go for low power RF, or can we use some other kind of wired interface to talk to the next layer? All these become very important decision making points in the lowermost layer of the IoT. Again, I stress upon the point that choosing the right components here is extremely important, because this is the one that gets rolled out in huge numbers in the field out there. The next layer is the gateway and network layer, which is about which gateway do I choose, which is the network do I select. It depends on the area in which I am rolling it out. I mean, if I am rolling it out in rural villages in India, for example, I need to be designing it such that I can use 2G if it is available. If it is 3G, I can use 3G. If it is 4G, or tomorrow if I am rolling out 5G, I should be able to make my applications or my gateway upgrade to use the next gen network. So that becomes an important aspect. And also, how many sensors in the lower layer it has to talk to, what are the security aspects that it needs to consider when talking to the sensors, how does it recognize the sensors automatically. All this becomes important in the gateway layer. The next layer is the management layer, which is about how do we as service providers manage the OSS, BSS, which are the telecom terminology, basically operation support system and billing business support systems, which is about which sensors to be turned on, what sensors will get what kind of service, how do I track where the sensors are deployed, what is the usage, how do I make sure that gateways are not misused, or let's say the SIM cards that have been put, or any other communication thing that has been put in is not misused. How do we know how many devices are deployed? Should it be automatically detected? And so on and so forth. All this becomes important aspect in the management service layer. The final layer is the application layer, which is where the intelligence gets applied on the data that keeps coming. What is important is that the data that comes from the IoT layers down cannot be presented to the users as it is. It doesn't make sense for the end users to look at data as it is. The data has to be interpreted. The data has to be presented to the users in a way that they can make sense out of it. Sometimes users may not be able to identify the trends and patterns. This is where artificial intelligence or big data comes into picture to analyze the large amount of data that is coming in and try to identify patterns identify for the user saying, hey, this means this event could be occurring. You might need to take this. You might need to take this action at this point of time, or even sometimes execute the action without even a human intervention as necessary. So, and of course, the application layer also involves end user applications or apps, smart apps, or other things that the users can use on their mobile or other things. So again, the same four layers. I talked about the sensor layer, the gateway management and application layer. The sensor layer, as I said, it interacts with the real physical world. That's where the rubber hits the road. It's a highly constrained embedded environment. Could be very low bandwidth, has to manage with very low power and very less memory. Gateway layer, of course, it has medium to high bandwidth. It could be 2G, 3G, 4G, available other network interfaces and so on. Security, and there might be some restrained power depending on where this is being deployed also, but mostly gateway layer, you don't worry about power that much. Some amount of edge computing can be done in this layer in order to take some decisions that may not wait till the data reaches the cloud and decisions are taken at the cloud at the central level. So some amount of edge computing can be applied in this level. So the next one is the management layer, as I talked about, all the OSS, BSS aspects, OTA, FOTA, upgrading the software, storage, business processes, all these will be considered in the management layer. The final layer of application layer, as I said, it's about, making sense of the data and take decisions, final decisions, or present it to the users of different types. And of course, the users might be of different nature as well. There can be let's say if we take banking as a domain, there can be customers of the bank who can be users, or the banking officials, or there can be RBI as a regulatory authority who's a user of the data. There can be different types of users. Depending on who's the user, different views of the data might need to be shown to the users as well in the application. Let me talk a little bit about the constrained devices in the bottommost layer that I refer to as the sensor or the physical layer. There might be more multiple types of classes. Class 0, class 1, class 2 is usually considered. Class 0 is extremely constrained, less than 10 kilobytes of memory is available for data, less than 100 KB of code size will be running on extremely thin, small footprint RTOS kind of OSS will be running on this. You can't run many strong security mechanisms on these. Most of these are pre-configured. You might not even be able to do OTA kind of services on these extremely constrained class 0 devices. Class 1 devices, you could try to start using things like some of the lightweight security protocols and so on. Class 2 is where you can start using even more better security, depending on which application you might have to choose the right device for you. And they usually have a very long sleep cycle in order to conserve on power. Many of them may be driven by batteries. If you deploy a device out there, for example, if in our case, if we deploy a device on a dairy animal's body to track the movement of the animal, I can't keep changing the batteries of the device every few days or every month or even years. So once I deploy the device, the device should run for quite a number of years with the available power it has. So it might have to have a lot of long sleep cycles in order to avoid power being consumed whenever it is not being used. It appears connected most of the times, but it need not be connected. It might connect once in a few minutes or once in an hour or so and send whatever data it has to send and again turn off its wireless interface in order to again save the power. Always on devices can be used for when the power is not that constrained. So event-based harvesting and battery that is periodically charged or replaced, etc., can be considered depending on what is the power source available on the sensors. The choosing of the network also becomes important in the IoT applications. On the left side, you can see the types of personal area networks that can be available for a designer to choose from. It can be low power RF, it can be Zigbee, it can be Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, depending on the power again that the sensor layer has access to. The right personal area network or local area network can be chosen. And the LAN can be used by the gateway in order to communicate with the cloud. So as I said, bandwidth, battery life, distance that needs to be covered, and discoverability of the devices, cost, and availability of the network becomes important points based on which we have to choose the network. So let me talk a little bit about discoverability aspects also. If we design the devices in such a way that it should be auto-discovered or it should be able to form a mesh network and so on, if those are the requirements, those have to be considered as a part of choosing the network. The network should be able to support some of these aspects as well. Some of the standardization groups involved in IoT standardization. IETF is working on the communication protocols like QoAP, Core, Role, 6LoWPAN, and other security related aspects. 3GPP is working on the control plane optimization and also the small data optimization for the IoT architecture. IEEE is working on the physical or MAC. So ZigBee and Wireless HART are also based on 802.15.4. FC and ITU, etc., are also working some of the application level standardization. Healthcare, ITU is focusing on healthcare applications, OSS is focusing on MQTT, powerline communication, etc. So, wanted to stress upon this fact that how artificial intelligence becomes important because the large amount of data that is coming in needs to be interpreted, understood, made sense of in order to deliver the best value to the users. So the data that is coming in from the sensors, all the things that are being sensed and that are connected needs to be interpreted by this intelligence. Only then it makes good value. So I can't stress upon how much AI and big data becomes relevant for IoT applications when end users start making use of it. So I would like to focus a little bit on what we as Stellabs are doing by using IoT in our solution architecture. We in Stellabs, we are focusing purely on the Indian dairy industry. When we got independence in 1947, we were 35th or 36th I think in terms of milk production in the world, and today we are number one in milk production in the world. So there has been fantastic work done by Dr. Kurian, NDDB, Amuls of India, and many other private dairies who have done this much work to bring India to number one milk production. However, we can't say that we are number one in terms of quality or even farmers' profitability. I'm not saying all over India there's a case. There might be many places in India where we have good quality or farmers might be profitable, but is this the case all over India? Definitely not. So there's a lot of scope for improving efficiency, resources the farmer uses, and to improve the quality so that the same more money can be plowed back to the farmer to get them more interested. As I said, India is the number one milk producer in the world, and the second one is US, and US is not even half the size of India in terms of milk production. So that big we are, and dairy along with the dairy sector, along with the cattle herd, cattle nutrition, veterinary services, etc. It's about 7.6% of India's GDP. That big is the dairy industry that impacts, that is in Indian economy. So our focus is how to improve, you know, farmers' profitability and quality, as I said. Just to give you a view, the Indian cow's average production is about 1,600 liters per year. One cow on an average gives 1,600 liters in a year, whereas the world average is somewhere around 15,000 liters or something. So like we are nearly 1/10 of the productivity. We make it up for sheer number of cattle in our country, which is about 300 million as we speak. Productivity or yield is per cattle is not good, and the farmers per farmer also, if you see, on an average a farmer has 2.6 cows or 3 cows. That is the average herd size of a farmer in India. Whereas the world average is about 100 cows or something like that. On an average, a farmer has 100 cows. So therefore, the farmer's ability to focus on quality and profitability reduces a lot. So we have been trying to apply IoT as a solution in the dairy industry. To give you a view of how the dairy industry works in India, me and you on all of us on this call probably buy milk from Amul or KMF or Mother Dairy or Akshaykalpa or one of these the milk and value-added services solutions or value-added products suppliers, but mostly none of them own any cows. They buy milk from the farmers. Farmers manage cows in their farms. It could be small farms with 2-3 cows, or maybe some farmers are bigger, but big farmers are very less in India. As I said, 99% of the farmers in India are small farmers with about 2 to 3 to 4 cows holding. So they buy milk from the farmers on a daily basis, every day twice. They buy milk from these farmers. In the tradition in India is to milk the cows twice. So the farmers do hand milking, or if some of them can afford or have access, they could do machine milking. Otherwise, mostly it is hand milking that is done, and traditionally morning and evening. And milk is such a substance that unless you cool it or boil it and process it in 3-5 hours time, it will go bad, it will curdle, or you know, it will be unusable after that. So milk has to be bought immediately by these dairy companies, because the small farmers have no easy way of managing the milk for a longer period of time. So the dairy companies, whether it is Amul, whether it is KMF, whether it is Mother Dairy, whether it is Kshekalpa, any of the dairy companies, Arokya, they all buy milk from the farmers every day, twice, once in the morning, once in the evening. So they the farmers get milk to these collection centers in small vessels, or it could be a small can or whatever it is, you know, or they may send their children to give the milk to the so-called dairies in their villages. So the traditional, these are called as village level collection centers or societies, because the cooperative movement has coined the term societies. So it could be a society, or it could be a VLCC level collection center, and so on. So this is where the farmers get the milk in these small vessels every day, morning and evening. The milk is bought by the operator here, and then the milk is transported to the chilling point, because milk has to be chilled and kept. You know, the most optimal chilling point for milk is 4 degrees centigrade. At 4 degrees centigrade, milk's shelf life is maximum. Other than that, bacterial growth, whether it is above that temperature or below the temperature, bacterial growth increases, and milk will get spoiled within a few hours. And anyway, by the time the farmer has milked the cattle and brought it to the collection center, usually 2 to 3 hours are gone. So you only have another 2 to 3 hours before which it has to be collected, transported and chilled. And it is not sufficient that you start doing it in 3 hours, okay, because you already spent 6 hours and milk is almost gone. So by the time, you know, in about 2 to 3 to 4 hours maximum of milking, the milk has to be in a chiller, or it should be processed. Otherwise, you can consider the milk as unusable milk. So chilling becomes important, and most of the dairies have the chilling centers or bulk milk cooling points at different places in villages out there near to the milking milk collection areas. Transportation is an important aspect. All of you, if you're traveling in the village rural areas, you might have seen these kind of vehicles moving around. The cans mean it is usually raw unchilled milk, okay? I mean, chilled milk will not be transported in cans, whereas chilled milk will be transported in tankers. And then of course the processing happens in the processing plants, and then the final end product is what we all buy. This is what we see in our shelves. If we go to walk into any of the stores in Bangalore or whichever city that we live in, or what gets delivered to houses in the morning is what finally the end product, this is what gets delivered. So in this entire supply chain is where Stellapps is applying IoT. It's a fantastic use case for IoT, because it's so much distributed out there in the real world. There are 300 million cattle distributed all over the state, all over the country. There are more than 5 lakh collection centers in the country, which is more than the number of post offices in the country. So that many places every day, morning and evening, farmers come and deliver milk. So IoT is so we have been applying our IoT solution in each of these points till the processing point. We have not gone beyond the processing. From the cattle till the processing is where we have applied our IoT solutions. MUON is about herd management. It's about cattle and farmer and the farm. MUON, MUCARE and MUSCORE are the applications, IoT based applications that were developed at the cattle and farm level, which takes care of the health monitoring of the animal, productivity, farmers' credit assessment, cattle insurance, and so on. SmartMCU, Mute, and SmartCC are the solutions that we use at the collection and chilling points. And Contract is about cold chain monitoring. As I said, ensuring that the milk is stored at 4 degrees centigrade is an extremely important aspect. People might not, you know, the users might not understand. I mean, somebody may think, oh, 4 degrees and 8 degrees is almost the same. I might switch off the diesel generator to save a few liters of diesel, if there's no power, which is usually the case in the rural India. So to save a couple of liters of diesel, maybe I'll turn off the chiller at 8 degrees. Or maybe, you know, I don't need to clean this chiller with hot water today. It's okay. That kind of compromises might be made purposely or unknowingly. So monitoring the cold chain becomes extremely important. As you all know, cleaning is a very, very important aspect in the dairy industry. If you take any vessel in which milk has been put and keep it after emptying the vessel, if you don't wash it, within a few hours, the vessel starts smelling, and the same thing happens in the entire supply chain. So cleaning in place, what is called a CIP, becomes extremely important, and Contract is a solution for monitoring the cold chain and cleaning protocols. And of course, other things such as potential pilferage or theft or other quality issues also can be monitored. Finally, MoveOpt and SmartFreeze and MoveFlow are about business processes, because it's such a big supply chain with so many farmers, so many transactions happening every day, that entire business process has to be managed well. So this is the suite of applications that we have developed at Stellabs. I would like to play the product video, please. So the move on device that you're seeing here, that the farmer is putting on his animal, is like our Fitbit, except that it detects the cattle's movement, and the battery has to last 5 years, as I said. Can we pause here for a minute, please? Yeah, so the solutions that we're seeing on this video at this point of time were about taking care of the cattle, taking care of the farm and farmer. So the MoveOn device that is in the cattle's leg is a device that that lasts for about 3 to 4 years with a battery that has been put in there. It uses low power RF to communicate. It gives the information about the cattle's movement, which is extremely important for the farmer to ensure that his cattle is yielding the is in the right lactation cycle. if it is standing too much, if it is sitting too much, if it is moving too much or too less, it means different things. And as you saw, there were apps and portals which a farmer might not use, but it is important that a veterinary staff have access to these things, or the insurance company have access to these things, or the banking partner who has given the loan to the cattle has access to these things. So different users need different view of the same data that you saw out there. So that is about the Moo on device. You also saw a brief glimpse of Moo ID, which is about cattle facial recognition. You know, how do facial recognition is being done out there for people, but we are trying to apply facial recognition for cattle so that cattle can be identified for insurance use cases, for cattle registration, etc. effectively. Please continue with the video. Smart AMC is about milk procurement. So this is about the farmers getting a transparent collection system. Farmers feel that they have a fair system that checks their milk quality properly, gives them the fair rate, make sure that they get paid without delays directly into their bank accounts. So each of the devices that you see on this in this picture is a thing for us, whether it is a milk analyzer, whether it's a weighing scale, whether it is a printer that you saw in that picture is a thing. We collect the data from it automatically and send it to cloud, and decisions are made what price should be paid to this farmer, which account to be paid, and so on. So as a dairy manager, I can decide, how my milk routes are performing, which route is good for cheese making, which route is good for UHT milk, where am I going to make loss in the next, summer, which could be the good route to expand, where could I be affected by competition, or maybe Diwali is coming, I need to increase 50 paisa per liter to get more milk. How do I control all those things centrally becomes extremely important for the dairy users. For the dairy companies, the farmer is not only a seller, but he is also a buyer. Farmer buys things from the dairy company as well. He may buy cattle feed, he may buy animal healthcare services. A farmer might need to take loans and so on. So Moo Flow becomes extremely important in order to manage the entire cash flow and reconciliation with the farmers. What you're seeing now is the chilling center where the milk is chilled. Large amount of milks are milk vehicles or milk cans are coming in. It needs to be immediately tested, and you need to start chilling because already 3 hours or 4 hours are over by the time milk reaches here, so it has to be chilled very quickly. So in this video that you're seeing, almost every device has a sensor built in, and they talk to each other wirelessly too. Provide the milk quality information and temperature and cleaning information. I'm back. Can you play the Sudha video, please? Sudha or Comfort is
मेरा नाम अरविंद कुमार है, मैं प्रबंध निदेशक के रूप में काम कर रहा हूं। इस संघ का नाम तिरहुत दुग्ध उत्पादक सहकारी संघ लिमिटेड है। हमारे प्रोडक्ट सुधा नाम से हैं, इसमें दूध, पनीर, लस्सी इत्यादि हैं, और ये हमारा मार्केटिंग सातों जिला के अलावा पटना में भी जाता है और कुछ प्रोडक्ट दिल्ली तक जाते हैं। हमारे पास 3,700 DCS हैं, किसानों की संख्या 1.5 लाख है और चिलिंग सेंटर 7 मैनुअल विधि से हम करते थे टेस्ट, उसमें कुछ इरर के चांसेस थे। उसमें मैनुअल लिखते थे रजिस्टर में, उसमें भी इरर होने के डर होते थे।
समितियों में दूध का जांच नहीं हो रहा था और किसान को सही पेमेंट नहीं मिल रहा था, तो हमारे जो दूध उत्पादक थे वो भी दूसरे तरफ शिफ्ट हो रहे थे।
स्टिल लाइफ्स क्लाउड बेस्ड प्रोग्राम है जिसमें IoT का सारा डाटा जाता है क्लाउड पे, और हमें ये फायदा है कि हम इसको अपने मोबाइल में भी देख सकते हैं कौन समिति ऑनलाइन कलेक्शन किया है, कौन नहीं किया है। क्या है कि कलेक्शन हमारा दिनों दिन बढ़ रहा है, दूध के रेट भी बढ़ रहे हैं, फैट SNF भी परसेंटेज बढ़ रहा है, जिसके कारण दूध का पर लीटर कॉस्ट भी अच्छा किसानों को मिल रहा है, एक किसान को फायदा दिख रहा है। विश्वास बढ़ा है, क्वालिटी बढ़ी है स्टेलेप्स के आने से के बाद।
तो ये मशीन आने के बाद में एक तो पारदर्शी काम होने लगे, किसान बहुत खुश है।
जब से मशीन लगा है, एक तो मुझे समय की काफ़ी बचत हो रही है और सारे किसान संतुष्ट हैं।
तो मशीन लगने के बाद से तो ऑटोमेटिक विश्वास किसान मेरा ही नहीं, हर किसान का विश्वास जुट गया है कि यह जो सामान हम देते हैं जिस कीमत का, उस हिसाब से हमको यहाँ पैसा मिलता है।
तो हम BMC चलाते हैं 4 से 3 डिग्री करने के लिए, अगर 2 डिग्री हो जाता है तो ओवर चिलिंग होने लगता है।
जो इस यह मशीन जो नहीं लगा था, इससे पूर्व हम लोग का दूध कितना बार नुकसान हो गया, B-grade C-grade हो गया सुधा के माध्यम से, डेयरी के माध्यम से जांच में, क्योंकि सही टेम्परेचर की जानकारी हम लोग को नहीं मिल पाती थी। अब ये मशीन यंत्र लगने के बाद नुकसान अभी तक नहीं हुआ है, टेम्परेचर को मेंटेन करके रखती है और सही रिपोर्ट हम लोग को मिलता है इस के माध्यम से। इसमें से अलर्ट से जो मेरे ऊपर जो पदाधिकारी हैं पर्यवेक्षक, उनको भी जाता है और मेरे पास भी आता है, और कहीं भी कोई इसमें डिफरेंस आया तो सूचना तो मिलता है, और सूचना आदान प्रदान से भी इस कार्य को करने में काफ़ी सुविधा मिलता है।
डेटा एनालिसिस स्टेलेप्स का करके हम लोग इन फ्यूचर प्लान कर सकते हैं, हमारा डिसीजन इस पर निर्भर करेगा, क्योंकि हम देख रहे हैं जहां अच्छा कर रहे हैं वहां किसानों का दूध का क्वालिटी बढ़ रहा है, फैट SNF बढ़ रहा है। तो इस तरह से हम एरिया टू एरिया डिसीजन ले सकते हैं और इसको इन फ्यूचर हम लोग ERP से जोड़ सकते हैं।
तो 17-18 के तुलना में 18-19 में लगभग हम 17% दूध के संग्रहण में ग्रोथ किए हैं। तो हम कह सकते हैं कि ये मशीन, और वैसे जहाँ जहाँ 352 समितियों में हम लोग ने मशीन लिया है, उन समितियों के भी संग्रहण के में ग्रोथ काफ़ी अच्छा देखा जा रहा है।
ये आने वाले समय के लिए और किसान के भविष्य के लिए बहुत अच्छा होगा, ये सक्सेस 100% हो, इस पर हम लोग अपना आगे की विचार विमर्श कर रहे हैं और प्रयास कर रहे हैं कि हर समिति में हम लगावें, और साथ में कि किसानों को काफ़ी उसके प्रति खुशहाली और जागरूकता दिख रहे, उसके तरफ ज़्यादा झुकाव है। तो हम भी चाहेंगे कि हम अपने संघ में जितने भी DCS है उसमें वो मशीन लगावें जिससे किसान को लाभ हो और संघ का भी हमारा हो, जो गुणवत्तापूर्ण दूध हमारे संघ तक पहुंच पावे।
हम ये देखते हैं कि अगर हमारी सभी समितियों में ये मशीन लग जाए तो रियली किसानों के लिए बहुत ही बढ़िया होगा, उनका विश्वास 100% हमारे साथ होगा, किसानों की आर्थिक स्थिति और सुदृढ़ हो जाएगी। तो हमारा प्रयास ये है कि हम अगले बार अगले लॉट में और ज़्यादा स्टेल्स की मशीन खरीदें अपने समितियों को दें, ये हमारा प्लान है।
Go back to slides, yeah. So, just wanted to give a view of what all other potential is there in the Indian, rural area. Of course, I mean, I don't have to talk much about the regular ones like smart cities and smart homes. But in the rural area, there are a lot of use cases which we as entrepreneurs can apply IoT to bring a lot of efficiency, whether it is greenhouses, contract farming, horticulture, fisheries, goat farming, poultry. There are tremendous opportunities in our economy to apply the IoT architecture and get the data and deliver value to the end users and the country. So that's what I wanted to talk about today. Maybe I will pause and take it forward.
Yeah. Yes, Ravi, thanks. I think we have a couple of questions, if you would like to take. So one is, what difference between the IoT platform and the IoT framework?
IoT platform and a framework? See, so I'm not sure what exactly are we referring to might be so IoT as a framework is an architectural reference. Okay, I mean, which layer are we talking about? And we are talking about the sensor layer, are we talking about the OSS, BSS layer or application layer and so on. IoT as a platform is something that we can reuse. Maybe there are IoT service providers out there who can provide us the platform. If I want to use if I want to build an application, I don't have to build everything. I could reuse the platforms that are being offered by service providers. So that is the platform that we could use. So there are many components that will be available that can be reused in the applications that we want to build and take it to market.
Okay, nice.
That's how I view the difference.
Okay. The other question of what we have is on the there's something called the jamming technique or the jamming attack in IoT. Or to complement that, are there any security challenges? Because there is a lot of data the sensors get right. So if you would like to throw some light on that. Yeah.
Yes, certainly. I mean, see, jamming cannot be avoided, but it can be detected. It can be detected that jamming is happening. You are suddenly losing data from some parts of your network, and automatically detect and throw it up as a user. It will be a part of the OSS BSS framework in the management layer that can indicate that in certain parts of your deployed network there are problems, right? I mean, it's as good as my jamming is as good as, let's say, my SIM is not getting signal. The final result is almost the same, right? And I stop getting the data from that part of the network, so I need go and see, okay, what's going on, why we are getting the this problem, and we could pinpoint it and then resolve issues.
Okay, yeah. Thanks, Ravi. I think this session beautifully captured as you said, the Internet of Things isn't about the internet. It's all about the things. The things are what changing. And if you covered the why IoT is currently the topic of such high exposure, drawing a lot of attention, and how concretely it works within an organization. So thank you once again, Ravi.
Thank you for having me today. All the best for the NASDAQ event.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.